Very brief. Dom has a presentation. I'll let you characterize yours, and then you can tell us what you want us to do, right? Mine will be very brief. I'm here to actually ask a lot of questions and hear more information from you folks about this and about your experience with access to records.
My name is Dominic Morrow. I'm a staff attorney with ReInvent Albany. We're a nonprofit open government watchdog group. And I have a presentation relatively brief, maybe not so brief, but relatively brief about how and why New York State's freedom of information law is not very good, why the process is in dire need of updating, and what we can do to pretty quickly to update that.
So where do you want to start? Do you want to start with that?
I would like to start with that.
And then talk about it, and then do input. Yeah. There's John Caney, Executive Director, ReInvent Albany. Shall we start with that? Shall we start with where these folks have identified things and then invite the conversation to go? Does that sound reasonable?
Sure. Cool.
Great.
All right.
Get out of your way.
Oops, that's not the right button. Close. All right. So, reinventing New York's freedom of information law. New York State has a freedom of information law. It applies to every government body in New York State. There's something like 10,000 of them, over 10,000 of them. The last time Cuomo had a report done on it. Freedom of information law, everybody's basically familiar with it. It requires governments to respond to written requests for records in their possession. There are relatively few agencies using an automated system right now. So very few agencies understand or have a concrete understanding of how many requests they get, what kind they get, how much it costs them to respond. And the state freedom of information law draws its inspiration from the Federal Freedom of Information Act. And so we've got some fun numbers for the federal version. There's 600 whatever federal FOIA requests in 2011. It costs $436 million. You can do some fun math. You can figure out the standard deviation, which I didn't include because I knew it would be right after lunch and that put everyone to sleep. But we get median cost, mean cost, right? There's some cool data you can do or numbers you can crunch. That pie graph was square last night. That's all right. So you get fun stuff like 8 agencies account for 3/4 of all the FOIA requests on the federal level. I thought that was kind of nuts. Department of Homeland Security, that mega agency combined that was created with what, like 30 separate agencies that got combined. No surprise, they're the largest one now. You get cool stuff like this. FOIA requests are the little white boxes. We get more and more FOIA requests nationally every year. But the mean cost per request actually has stopped going up. Coincidentally, that's in 2011, that's when President Obama's Open Data Initiative really kicked off. Correlation doesn't imply causation, but I am totally implying causation. But that's not the correlation's fault. So back to New York State. Here are the stats for New York. We don't have any. The New York Freedom of Information Law, unlike the federal law, doesn't require New York State agencies to count or report or measure anything. So I have no idea how many FOIA requests there were in 2011. I kind of do. I'm going to get to that. But so we don't get cool pie charts that are oblong or otherwise. We don't get cool line graphs. So the most fundamental tool for transparency in New York State is completely opaque. That's ironic for one, but not good. So we can't measure New York State's FOIA request process. And since there's no reporting process, we can't compare different agencies. We can't compare different processes. We don't know who's got the best practices, if there are best practices, what those best practices are. We've got some inkling, but it's 2012. There's no reason that it should be where it is right now. Excuse me. So we've tried to estimate it. There was a survey done by a Binghamton University graduate student in 2011. She estimated the cost of finding FOIA documents at about $100 per request. That's just finding. That doesn't count, lawyer time, looking over stuff, scribbling on it with a Sharpie, mailing it out. That's just finding the documents. The city of Yakima, Washington, where the legal penalties are staggeringly huge for screwing up a FOIL request, so they take really good care of their FOIL requests. They say they spend more than $1,200 per request just on lawyers, lawyers and processing and, you know, covering their asses. So we're assuming it's probably somewhere in the middle, and the federal cost is $700 per request. That's finding the documents, you know, getting the lawyers to review the documents, sending the that's everything. So, but that does represent a pretty big investment in IT to improve the efficiency. And so $700 is the national average. It actually varies quite a bit. The Federal Social Security Administration is the blue box on the left. Their average cost is $123 per request, which is way less than the federal average of $650 for fiscal year 2011. CIA is in that little inset thing on the right. I actually couldn't fit the whole number line on the slide, even though it's done in a nice widescreen. But yeah, $4,000 a request for the CIA. Yes.
Sorry, Mark, but is there a do you have any measure of what the size of the information per request is?
Excellent question. No, they don't keep track of that. They do have something called they have three categories that they're required to break these requests down into called. Complex requests, simple requests, and expedited requests. But as far as I can tell, that doesn't reflect at all the number of pages or the time they estimate working on these things. The correlation between average cost per request and ratio of complex to simple requests, I graphed it in Excel. The correlation is about 0.2. So that's like insignificant, meaningless. So whatever they do theoretically categorize them, but practically, they don't, which sucks. But you're onto something, because I've talked to the Federal FOIA Ombudsman, and the Federal Social Security Administration, the records that they're handing out, a page or two, tops. I mean, it's people, you know, who want their files of their grandparent or something, or their spouse. Like, one page. Like, this is your, you know, this is your husband's Social Security number. Done. Like, it's not complicated. The CIA, a little bit more complicated. You know, I want to know everything about Elvis and Area 51 and, you know... So that's more complicated. That requires a lot of legal review. So, yes, it's not just that, you know...
Wait, I thought you said this didn't cover legal review.
No. This is everything related to FOIA costs.
Okay.
The Broome County number didn't cover legal review.
Okay, thank you.
So this is the federal cost. And so it's not just that the Social Security Administration, they have their act together, and the CIA doesn't. It's like you said, it's related to the complexity of the records they're handing out. And that's pretty much what I just said. The EPA, they're somewhat in the middle of that number line. Their documents that they hand out, thousands and thousands of pages of, you know, Superfund data, pesticides produce these birth defects in these kinds of cats, but not these kind of cats, I don't know. So, and the other thing that exacerbates the range is that last bullet point. We don't really have a lot of collaboration until the EPA's new FOIA portal that just launched. We'll talk about that a little bit later. So let's compare that $700 figure to the United Kingdom's version of FOIA. I think they call it public information requests, but FOIA costs. $237 per request. That's, on average, their request. They've invested in technological systems. They don't do everything by hand. They don't, they're doing really cool stuff with document management systems. They've made significant investments in these things to make the process more efficient. And they've invested in open data, an open data approach to just give away more data start with. They don't need people to ask for the records, so they have fewer records. So the United Kingdom is that little gray box.
And I have to clarify, they have a different approach to FOIA and privacy. There's not a presumption of access, and then the list of things that you can deny access to, and privacy is much different in
the
UK.
So they have more legal review, or?
No, I'm not saying, I don't know either way, but the law has a different presumption in it with respect to privacy and what's withheld.
Sure.
So there's another big area.
Sure. No, they have not ratified federal FOIA law in England. I think we'd have to fight a second revolution to settle that one. But so the United Kingdom is the gray box over on the left, and even though it's not exact, the language doesn't exactly track, the general principle applies. You send in a request, you get a document. And for the UK, it costs about, you know, less than half of what the federal government costs.
We see a trend in the volume of requests.
They're
based
going
on
up.
The number of the volume of requests are going up.
Yeah, yeah. Unfortunately, before 2007, the federal reports on FOIA requests lumped together FOIA requests and Privacy Act requests. And while there were about 450,000 FOIA requests in 2007, there were something like 19 million Privacy Act requests. So the number would like start at 21 million and then drop down to 500,000 once they stopped counting privacy. I don't know why they reported those numbers side by side, but the Department of Justice now just reports FOIA numbers, and I think they have Privacy Act stuff in another number. So we're going to go ahead. I mean, I said earlier that in Broome County, the average cost would work out to about $100 per request to just find the document and without legal review. So if you take like an hour or two of a lawyer's time and then, you know, another employee to send out the stuff, $300 per FOIA request, that's, you know, we'll use that as a working estimate. I think that's pretty conservative because, again, the federal government has made a lot of investment in, you know, open data and information technology and efficiency gains that New York State just hasn't yet. So less than half the cost of the federal government's really IT-heavy approach, I think, is generous. So we've, you know, here are some data points that we've collected. I've called up places that do keep track for one reason or another. Rochester has a really nice FOIL database. New York City, the Office of the Public Advocate, just did a survey where they FOIL'd all city agencies and literally added together the numbers. So they came up with a really useful number for us. We've got numbers from Urbana places. So we find out that actually we get about 13 FOILs per year per 1,000 residents in cities. This is a broad estimate, I know, but you know, this is as best we can do unless we have better stats. For counties, it's 9 FOILs per year per 1,000 residents, and the only state that keeps track that's not, you know, something really small like South Dakota, where they can say 4. We get 4 FOIL requests, and 3 of them are about cows. Nobody hears from South Dakota, right? That'd be terrible.
Born there, Yankton.
No, really? You kidding?
I'm serious.
What are the odds? 1 in 50. thank you. So the state of Texas gets about 41 requests per 1,000 people per year, but they have this really weird, like, tax department, comptroller, finance, mega agency. And they count a lot of stuff that probably aren't technically FOIL requests or wouldn't be FOIL requests in New York. So, you know, if we reduce that down to something that's more proportional to what the IRS gets compared to the federal government, Texas is probably more like 25 FOILs per 1,000 people per year. So for New York, if you add up those numbers, that would be about 47 FOILs on the city, county, and state level per 1,000 people per year, which works out to, given the 19-whatever million people in New York, about that many FOILs a year, 900,000. I'm happy to be proven wrong on that. I would really, really be happy to be proven wrong on that. That again, that's accounting for all cities, all 60-whatever cities, all however many counties, and towns and state agencies. And so if we use that $300 conservative estimate, we're going to go with about $275 million a year in this antiquated FOIL process. So, at the federal level, we, like I said, they collect statistics. We have those cool charts that we don't have in New York. The FOIL law the federal FOIL law requires the agencies to report, excuse me, to the Department of Justice the number of requests received, the ones they've processed, the ones they've denied and appealed. You know, they collect a lot of information. Again, the complex, simple, expedited distinctions without differences, apparently. And the total cost of responding to requests and to litigating requests, and it's actually impressive. Litigation is like, you know, 2% of the overall cost of FOIA at the federal level. I would have thought it'd be a lot higher than that.
Expensive to litigate. For
yeah,
the claimant.
For the claimant.
So the lawsuits are rare.
Whatever works. So there is no such...
You're not rolling in money anymore, huh?
Rolling in money, go figure.
So there's no reporting in New York, so we're kind of clueless. This would be, you know, I don't want to say it's a simple fix, but just having a reporting requirement means that, you know, no matter how bad the federal government is at FOIA, at least we can quantify it. You know, we can talk about it. The really funny part here is that agencies are only required to provide documents that exist that they have. So if you FOIL them for FOIL statistics, if they've never written down the FOIL statistics because they don't count, you don't get anything. We've got FOILs into about 20 state agencies and authorities at the moment. The MTA just flat out said, no, we don't have anything, go away.
How does the FOIL request come into the agency?
You can email the agency, you can write it.
It document.
Fax, yeah, you have to write it down. It has to be a written request. So
doesn't it have to be written? So can't you FOIL request?
Can we ask an expert on this?
I don't know where to start. Can you ask the question again?
If the FOIL request has to come in somehow
in
documented, can't you FOIL for that request?
Yes, requests are public.
So can't you build statistics on how many FOIL requests there are?
Requests are only required to be kept for a period of 6 months or 6 months after the date of the last appeal has expired. So some agencies dump their records after 6 months because there's no requirement to keep them in.
So you get the FOIL request for 6 months and extrapolate over...
Every month I would say, I want the last month's FOIL request before you throw them out.
If one person in the agency were keeping all of the written requests, and if the agency only considered written requests, if the agency considered only written requests, FOIL requests, yes.
So the answer to that is it's been done, and yes, and the NYCLU did this with the New York State Department of Education and had to litigate to get it, and they got the title of every single, basically the front page of every FOIL request that was in their records. It took them, with a phenomenal amount of work on the public side to be able to compel them to produce that, and quite expensive because then they had to copy all of those. And they didn't just, and it was initiated by this very exercise in which the NYCLU said, tell us how many FOIL requests you have and how long it takes you to respond to them. And the answer they got was, we don't know. And they said, okay, we will FOIL every single FOIL that you've received. And they went about this collation exercise. It was a massive amount of work to do. So in theory, you're right, but the actual doing it is not practical.
There's definitely got to be improvements to that system of getting this FOIL request, but it's a complicated subject because there is privacy concerns.
Oh, sure.
In those FOIL requests.
For some of the FOIL requests. Yeah. Most FOIL requests.
I'd ask for the caption or the the thing and the actual, if there's any personal information being requested, you can just delete that.
And so somebody in Hawaii, a newspaper in Hawaii, tried to do that with all the state's FOIL requests, and the state sued to get it stopped because they calculated it would be $3 million, $4 million just to give copies of all the requests and something like that. So it gets, and that's just Hawaii. There's I don't even know, a couple hundred thousand people in Hawaii? I don't know. But it's not a state the size of New York, to say the least. The other thing, the federal FOIL level, the one we're using is a good model for reporting requirements. You don't have to. All you need is just to make a account. Just keep account. So in the absence of account, then foiling the FOIL requests would be one option. It'd be really, really logistically difficult, and if the same person, what you said, didn't keep all the records, it'd be tricky.
So can I ask a quick question?
Please.
Just thinking about this. So if the number of FOIL requests is increasing every year,
yes,
and they cost a lot of money to do, I'm just wondering, is there a value, and I don't want to just derail the conversation, but is there a value to talking about proactive disclosure?
Oh, we get that.
As opposed to...
Let's get there, because
it's a long joke.
Really short on time.
Are we really short on time?
Yeah.
Okay. So the federal FOIL, this isn't new. Reporting's been done in the federal level since 96. They've got almost 20 years of data. We've got zero. Paper versus electronic. Paper is lame. It takes forever. Electronic is awesome. It takes less time. The process in New York is overwhelmingly manual, despite a couple of places like the Department of Health using some really, really sweet e-FOIL systems with document management system, searching, tagging, scanning, harder, better, faster, stronger. So some of the features of these e-FOIL systems, intake of FOIL requests through a public form, just like a feedback form on a website. I mean, you don't need to, you can fax in your FOIL requests, but that's not cool. Publishing previously requested records, like a bug tracker. Everyone here is familiar with open source software, bug trackers, that sort of thing. I have a problem with this software. I'm going to go to this central place to type out my problem with the software, and then one of the developers can come by, and everyone else in the world can see it and search for it and say, oh, I have this problem too. FOIL requests are not unlike bug reports in that way. Bug reports are public. Previously requested records, they ought to be public. And you could allow users to track the status of their requests. I mean, the same way that, if you've ever reported a bug on open source software bug tracker, You can see, oh, it's been assigned to this developer, and you know now he's shut it down because my request is lame, and I just wanted him to add more sparkles.
So does anybody in the state
by the way,
now?
No.
Any
public trackers? No.
There's some local governments
yes.
who publish the records that have been requested online. There's some local governments. I think you're onto something here as a suggestion for what we could propose for a change to the law. I think that we need to be careful about spending our time posting everything, although I understand the greater value. I understand the, you know, then you get accused of picking and choosing.
Sure.
But what we're hoping, what we've been talking with state archives about getting records online too, because they're the other kind of advocate for open records and getting data available, is talking about records that are frequently requested and have, I'm not coming up with the jargon right now, but that are valuable, you know, either temporarily or long or have historic value, but requesting, there's another phrase there, so that we're sure that at least those records get up online.
Definitely.
So I think actually that's a good idea.
Let's try to get to the end.
Sure.
We're almost there.
Sure. And so it's not just the one last thing on the public records thing. It's not just good for people for like the citizens. I've come across a couple of local governments that you know they've had their FOIL process really abused. Like somebody just has a grudge against the mayor, so they just request every single email the mayor's ever sent,
yeah,
like
exactly.
50 times a year. And so those places by themselves they start publishing all their FOIL requests online. So you can see, yeah, no, Martha down the street's being a jerk, and she's taking up all the time down to City Hall. So, benefits of e-foil systems. You want me to just skip past all the...
No,
all
this
right.
is key.
Just okay, all
right. Keep it concise. This
right.
is important.
So, the federal EPA, they just launched a online FOIA portal. They say that it'll save $200 million over the next 5 years if just a simple, you know, majority of agencies adopt it. I mean, that's the average agency, $16 million a year, or $16 million in savings in 5 years because it increased efficiency in processing this stuff. The Department of Health, they've already moved to something like that. This in 2007, their FOIL backlog has been reduced by 90%. Doing stuff with computers is way faster than doing it with on paper. Department of Defense reduced their labor costs, 33%, 90%, yes, yes.
Do these e-FOIL systems tie in to any of the back ends?
I'm wondering how the efficiencies, how you come up with the efficiencies.
Some of them do. Some of them are just built as document management systems that never see the light of day, and they take paper requests, and some clerk types in the paper requests into the electronic back end, and that still saves, you know, that's on the lower end, like 33% labor time. But some of them are public-facing. I mean, with the Department of Defense, it's trickier because there's an awful lot of really classified stuff that can't ever be public-facing. There's like an air firewall. So that's why the wide range in 33 to 90%. It's you know the more automated you make the system, the more time you're going to be saving. I mean, that's just
okay. So you're just saving time on the workflow process.
Yeah, exactly, and you're letting people collaborate and not wait for intra office mail. You know, the record has to go from the records office, you know, maybe to another building.
That triggers and all that in the system.
Yeah, exactly. Or maybe automated processing of or automated creation of response letters, something like that. So this is proactive disclosure. This is what you're talking about. So the federal EPA has they uploaded about 800 documents in 2009 that were really, really, really popular. They knew they were really popular because they had this e-FOIL system that kept metrics. They had statistics about this stuff. These 800 documents made up 20% of all FOIA requests to the EPA in 2009. And now they are 3% of the FOIA requests to the agency. They've preempted literally thousands of FOIL requests, and these are 800 documents, which are about 150,000 sheets of paper combined. They are really, really detailed records about pesticides, of all things. So if you put really popular documents online, just one data set, just pesticides, you cut down the volume of FOIA requests you get in a year by 15%. So they get more than 10,000 FOIAs a year. 15% of that's about 2,000. The average FOIA cost in 2009 was $1,700 per request. So they've saved, on average, $3.4 million just by uploading 800 popular documents about pesticides. And so that's just one data set. That doesn't even begin to scratch the surface. And they testified to Congress later that, you know, based on that sort of result just from one data set. When they put a lot of data sets on data.gov, they think they can reduce their number of FOIA requests by another 20%. And again, they only get like 10,000 a year. This is not, you know, hundreds of thousands like statewide. I mean, you could, we're talking millions of dollars for an agency that just gets, you know, a few thousand requests a year. The Secretary of Defense's office, again, they've done this similar estimate. They think that they could cut it down by 60%, not just, 15 and 20. So going back to the survey in Broome County earlier, one county department tried this out. They figured out what records people wanted. You know, it was a smaller department. They didn't necessarily have an awful lot of records, so they kind of knew where most of the action was happening. They cut down the number of hours they spent just in man hours, 5 hours a week. And in Broome County, it's not a very big place, the six most heavily FOIA departments actually spend 5 hours a week processing requests on average. So almost five, more than five, subtracted by, minus almost five, equals almost zero. So you can really cut down your workload, save a lot of money. And there are lots of ways to do this. You can use open data platforms. New York City's got that open data platform. Talked about CCAN and data.gov, and I have to mention Socrata now because you're here, Marcus.
New York City.
Oh, that's right. We were just making fun of that, actually, yeah. And you have reading rooms with the frequently requested documents, like you were saying, Camille. CCAN, data.gov, open data portal. They come in very many different colors. It's great. Electronic reading rooms, this is the FBI's one about unexplained phenomena. This is like literally the X-Files. FOIA, the federal FOIA law actually mandates you create reading rooms. I mean, this isn't the FBI doing it because they really, really want to see X-Files come back for another movie. This is, you know, they have to do it. And they do it manually, though. I mean, this isn't an automated thing. If you just had every request which came in be put on this site and, you know, you let the site figure out which are the most popular documents, you could cut out all the labor involved in maintaining one of these reading rooms. So to wrap it all up, we've got four basic recommendations for New York State. One, just make New York State agencies report FOIL statistics like the federal government already does, like Texas already does. Two, agencies ought to be using automated FOIL systems. The Department of Health in New York State already does this, and they get crazy results. Haven't been able to talk to them just yet about how crazy the results are, but they won awards for this at the awards shows. They've talked about how amazing their results are, like 90% reduction in FOIL backlog in like a year. Mandate electronic reading rooms with frequently requested documents. This is, you know, basic proactive disclosure. You know, if it was popular once, it could be popular again. And you hopefully already have a scanned copy of it, so why not? And then start working on actual proactive disclosure, like data.gov and the New York City Open Data Law. You can probably figure out what's going to be popular and just upload it on their site. So if you take New York City's number from before and you put those numbers together, you get almost $90 million a year you could save just with a little bit of proactive disclosure. We've got $41 million from reducing FOIL volume from having reading rooms like the federal FOIA already requires, and $46 million with an extra 20% reduction in FOILs for an open data approach. This is not even improving the process itself. This is just in avoiding getting these requests at all. So I kind of said that already. No meaningful metrics. We want metrics. Simple steps. Lots of millions of dollars of savings. Yes, that's my presentation. Thank you.
Great. Thank you.
So one thing that strikes me as a mechanism to try to get as much labor-free FOIL requests handled as possible is that if you require in the duplication step, either digitization or copying a digital file or physically copying something, if you require that a digital copy be held, I'm presuming that New York can afford that kind of storage, because I could probably afford that storage for that.
Seriously, right?
And if you just require that, or as an alternative, if something's rejected, that you specifically mark this was rejected so that you don't also have the negative cost of going and finding something and then finding the reason it was rejected again, mm-hmm. then at least in that way, you could, every request is a maximum of one effort, mm-hmm. and you could use that corpus to decide which data sets you should fill out. This is one document, we scan every page with this one.
Yeah, no, that'd be great.
In the abstract.
I can. I used to process FOIL requests as an intern at a couple of agencies in New York City, And just digital never entered into it. It was all paper stuff. So if we had made digital copies of anything, that would be a great idea. I don't know how widespread
you could,
that practice
you could
is.
You need a scanner. Just stick a stack of papers on there, and it.
Yeah,
I
mean,
I know,
it's
you
very
say this like it's so easy, and John and I and other people in state government are like.
It seems like
the
basic stuff.
For someone
there,
who has a computer
me,
science
there
degree,
is a desire. There is a desire. You know, here I am, Committee on Open Government. We tried to get a scanner. We tried to get a scanner. Okay, we can't afford a scanner, so we got a scanner that's from 19 who knows when, and it scans. But then you have to go in and correct what the words are, because they didn't transcribe correctly. Like, you know, the word where is what instead of where, and I'm going, it's going to take me longer to correct the thing than it is to just answer the thing, you know? So then the question was, well, could we have some content management software so that we could just pay somebody else to scan all our records in, or give them to another department, they would scan them all in, and then we could have our little document management system here at our desk. Yes, we could do that, but no, it's not in the budget. No, the answer is no, it's not in the budget. So yes, I'm glad you're here, that we need lobbyists we need people to lobby for these things as priorities, and I'm grateful for that. I wish it were as simple as let's just get a content management
I wish I were still at RPI, because I'm sure any of my classes I could have just said, who has a form feeding scanner that they're willing to give up so that
right.
we can do
right.
automatic FOIL.
Well, anyone,
yeah.
There's regulations about accepting stuff from people too,
from
as
academia,
far as
or handing over private
documents. But let's stick with that conversation about what kind of suggestions we can make to.
This session is going to be over in like a couple minutes, but I'm wondering if we want to another session to kind of go over any of this, to continue this conversation. Is anyone? I'd
like to talk about.
Yeah.
Yes.
Do you have specific statutory language you had up there?
I do. Yes, I do. So are we literally over in like 2 minutes?
Can we look at the schedule? Can we look at the schedule?
Yeah, like 5 minutes.
Yeah. Yeah. Dean, if that would be all right, I would love to go to another session.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So build on her comment, one thing I kind of wanted to see, I work for DEC. I like the idea of open data and open government and proactive disclosure. The problem is there's going to be an effort to do that. It's going to cost money. It's going to take people to process. I mean, there's legal concerns about what data do we even have and what stuff of that. Do we have any DMV IDs, or do we have any social security numbers that we can't disclose?
Yeah.
Also, is there certain things that are okay to disclose in isolation, but maybe not when connected to other data? For instance, it might be for Department of Health or something, it might be okay for them to disclose how many prescriptions are written for certain drugs, but if they have another table that tells who that prescription was for, it might not be okay to release both of those in conjunction, because then you will find out people's personal health.
So
some things might be okay to release in isolation, but not when there's other data.
Sure.
So all that takes analysis, and then there's the process of just building whatever system. Either you're going to do a data dump, or if you want to build something that's more continuous so that you keep publishing the data, there's going to be an effort there.
Yeah.
So unless there's some kind of mandate or law, there's not going to be, we're too busy fighting fires as it is, we're not going to have the time to do that proactively.
So you're in the crosshairs because DEC is known to have the most foiled single set of databases of any agency, which is the parcel data for air, soil, water samples, which are heavily, you know, you get a mortgage for a house, the insurance company wants it before the bank gets it for the mortgage, et cetera, something like 6,000 to 8,000 foils a year for that. It's ripe for proactive disclosure and open data treatment. I think it's going to get it. What you're talking about is exactly right. And the absence of metrics, the only reason we know this is because DEC has a great FOIL officer, probably the best, and she actually attends to these things. But even she doesn't have the exact count, because they don't use an automated document management or, you know, FOIL processing system. So it's very hard to figure that out.
It's also interesting. I think she's one of the best records access officers in the state also. She's a real powerhouse. And at some point in her dealing with electronic records, she decided it wasn't worth it to charge anybody anything anymore. It's just not worth it. Just go. You want it? It's yours. Go. It wasn't worth it ever. So she just does it now. She's awesome.
But as one of two, and bringing on a couple more that are transferring from other areas, but one of two main Java developers, I know we have a backlog of projects that need to get done of 3, 4, 5 years out.
Sure.
So doing proactive disclosure systems are not going to get done unless the governor or some legislature comes down and says, you have to do this.
Well, or what I'm thinking is, nobody's going to actually prioritize it until they can see how much benefit comes back on government for doing this. And although I appreciate your statistics about money and time, I'm a little wary of some of the numbers.
I'm a lot wary.
What I'm hopeful about is that we are starting to see, and in fact, one of the sessions later today, I think Dean's running, is the evidence of the decrease in costs based on the open data efforts. And I think that's where I'd like to focus.
Yeah, to be clear, what I'm looking at is basically in the, you know, kind of the greater economy, the value that's being generated. So this is still going to cost money, but you're looking at it as an investment.
Right. Weather, GPS, yeah.
As far as what Chris said about not knowing exactly what to even disclose, Committee on Open Government, you guys write like thousands of opinions constantly about these sorts of things. Are these the sort of things that...
They have two people, though. If I give them a couple thousand...
Oh, no, just like rules of thumb. No, no. No, I don't mean like sending her like 1,000 data sets or something.
I have to get approval from my manager first.
Right.
Convince them that there's a...
Do you guys have, like, you know, open data or proactive disclosure guides or something? Would that be the sort of thing that you guys could, just like rules of thumb? I mean, you already know about the DMV numbers and the Social Security numbers, but, you know, there's probably other stuff that the unknown unknowns.
Obviously, a lawyer at our agency would have to make that determination.
Sure.
I think it's straightforward enough to sit down with Ruth and an attorney from DEC and maybe Bob or I, but I think between at least those three people, you could probably go through a database, come up with those metadata as we were talking earlier, come up with those little tags, which fields need to be tagged for that kind of stuff.
Right.
I don't know that it's...
And just to kind of throw in, I think something that you raised yesterday and that Bob said today and presentation is really important, that it's really valuable to design systems with that in mind. In other words, the whole point is, like, no one would actually do that. No lawyer would be like, come on down, we're developing a new database, we want to figure out what's private and what's public. That, you know, most people would be like, well, what are you talking about? Let us know when this becomes an issue on a FOIL standpoint.
So can we slide into the next session here, or?
Well, what we're going to suggest is the room's booked already for another group, and I don't want to bump them out of the way. But we have a couple overflow rooms in room 211. They're actually really cushy chairs. If you guys think this is a neat topic you want to talk about further, I'm actually really kind of interested in this. We'd be happy to like invite people to take a walk over there, and then continue the session for another one.
Okay. Because what I really would like to talk about is that how you get to the point where you can do that design stuff together.
Yeah, and I'm very interested in
and other hurdles that
how do you tackle small groups too? Like, how do you deal with the localities who are like, you know, like we want to do, we think this is all neat, but you know, I don't have an IT shop. You know, I'm the person stuck doing this.
Some of them don't even have websites.
Well, and we have Megan Sutherland here from Center for Technology and Government who has done a study on that particular question.
Oh, see, great group to have here. Our timing is perfect. If only we had a whole day just for this topic. But what we can do is, if you guys are interested, I think we're coming up on... It's 2 o'clock now. We got a few more minutes. Actually, I guess it's now, right?
Yeah, now.
And it'd probably take us about 3 minutes to walk over to our other space. If you guys are interested, anybody who wants to come, take a walk. We'll walk over together.
Sounds good.
Cool.
The next one is open standards.
Yeah. That's a challenge for this. Wish they could be like, we just have one big long row because there's so many interesting topics I hate. And I was like, hey, let's continue this one. Well, wait a second.
Does the next session start at 2:15?
Yes.
Can we stay here then just for till 2:15?
Yeah.
Maybe we can do that within that time frame and see where we go after that?
Sure.
Okay.
One resource that comes to mind that you may not have thought of is Richard Stallman and people like him who are who are they are a little bit weird socially, but but they're passionate. And he's one of the people who's been really strongly for open everything.
Yeah.
And if you were to say approach the GNU Software Foundation, if there's any missing software that needs to be written, they command a fairly significant army of people who want to be ethical coders, and they might be willing to do a lot of the work that you might normally have to pay for. It'll probably be written in C and C++, because that's what GNU does.
But, GNU.
GNU.
The technology piece of it, which is, there's really two technology aspects we talk about. There's three recommendations. One is a policy framework, or, you know, mainly reporting, which would involve either an executive order from the governor to state agencies or a change in state law that would cover everyone. And then there's two technology platforms we talked about. One is automating the document management of FOIL requests, and there's three or four major products on the market, commercial products, all of which we would recommend because they would save tons of money for people who have unautomated systems. The seat license for those is between $600 to $1,000 a year, roughly. Some localities balk at that cost, which is hard to believe, given that the savings that different, you know, like the Army Medical Corps did a study, and the saving per license was in the tens of thousands of dollars. So I'm going to say it's something like $100,000 for spending $800, you know. So we're talking massive savings here. You know, the difference between paper and a process. There's a big discussion nationally, if people are interested, about creating civic shareware, open source software that is dedicated to FOIL management. The EPA just created a system for the entire federal enterprise that is a document management system. It's our open FOIL system that we were hoping would be open sourced and available to all levels of government to use. That didn't happen, but it's a discussion that we would like to see. The crisis is at the town, village, and county level for sure, where, you know, FOIL requests are super expensive and bulky and difficult. So that's one piece of it. The other piece is open data and creating an open data ecosystem, you know, with a policy framework, a law, an executive order, et cetera, which we're now seeing in New York City in a big, big way. In fact, March 7th of next year is the Big Bang Day, where all data already on New York City websites has to be put in a machine-readable format, which is a huge, huge amount of data. And I think will impact on FOIL significantly. There are a number of open data platforms, including Socrata, and we have one of their developers in the room with us right now, which is terrific. And Socrata, in fact, has dealt directly with FOIL in Chicago. They're putting all the FOIL logs are all online for City of Chicago right now on a Socrata platform, probably other places too. So in terms of software, I think we're in pretty good shape. What we're terrible is that we don't have good laws or standards or orders.
So let's go there. If I can jump in here, John, let's go there. This is the language that we have to deal with right now. This is our language. This is the language that was adopted in 2008 that says you need to keep an eye towards what's public and what's not required to be made public when you're designing your information systems. Do you have any suggestions? Should it be better? What, you know, do you have ideas?
Well, designing information retrieval methods, perhaps designing its information systems to begin with to take into account this this requirement and other requirements.
We loosely interpret it as designing information systems, but you're right, the language says retrieval methods.
That's after the fact.
Has anyone run into this provision in their work at a state agency or in the outside? I mean, are you aware of this?
No.
And then this is for only new systems.
Correct. When designing.
And something from, like, not modifying.
It's not retroactive. Right. No. So, is that something that, that's kind of an awkward mandate to go back and change all your legacy systems. I mean, talk about expense.
Huh. I assume that's a practical and reasonable threat clause, right?
What could we tie it to that would be...
Go ahead.
What could we tie it to that would not be immediately compulsory, that would be part of normal maintenance to spread it out? I mean, could there be some kind of... I'm thinking back at the project I did when I was in computer science, and there's so much maintenance being done, but it's so hard to articulate from the outside what you have to do to evolve a system towards this.
Yeah.
But I think we could get an expression of that and make that part of the maintenance process, then you could force all these legacy systems without the shock cost of upfront, okay, convert everything now.
Like an agency in designing or upgrading its information retrieval. But I guess that's kind of the point of a legacy system.
That's not true.
No?
You upgrade systems all the time.
Right.
Is that what it's called when you are?
We do. We're in the middle of a system upgrade right now for our mainframes, and we have software from the vendor. We have local code that needs to be inserted into the software. That's called an upgrade, and we do that every year or two, because otherwise, if you just stay stagnant, for one thing, the vendor doesn't support the software anymore. So
holes, and someone ends up with
So
you could definitely interpret designing as, designing or incrementally upgrading.
The problem with that, if you then say, okay, we're doing a system upgrade because we need to maintain basically the ability to have the vendor support our product, but that's the underlying software. That's not the applications that run on that.
Right.
I'm involved with the actual, it's called UDS software. It's a Unisys mainframe. It's our database stuff. But we have hundreds and hundreds of programmers who write the actual applications that run on that. That's what would have to be changed. That's not changing.
Right.
So again, how do you define that?
Well, this is assuming that this is the big problem, that segregation of data, and I'm not at all convinced that that's a big problem. I think that, as our slideshow introduced, the problem is that there's no metrics, so we don't know what is happening at all. And I'd also suggest that since we have a framework for an open data law that we just passed in New York City and wrote last year that is, fantastic, and there's a version of that in the assembly, that hasn't gone anywhere, but we haven't tried to push it, that we could jump over this. I mean, this is a thing to work on and evolve, but it's not clear at all that this is, a major impediment to going forward.
What other suggestions might you have? Have you run up against, Hendler talked about the priority of getting government databases to be able to relate to each other. Are there ways that we can help with changes to the law that would do that?
I'd be hesitant to use a legal framework for that, because
it's kind of too big a question.
I think the legal framework would be too rigid, because part of the issue with working with databases and these data sets is that you have to be really flexible, and that you have to have as little artificial structure imposed on it as possible to be able to use it in arbitrary ways to combine. And so a legislative attempt at that would probably do more harm than good by creating these artificial disjoint features of the data that would interfere.
One of the things I learned about the United Kingdom in one of the previous presentations of Jim Hendler is that there is the ability to issue an executive order that everybody will use the same open data platform. In a way that there isn't in the United States.
Their data now, is that by statute or anything, or is it just executive order? How does that happen?
It's executive order, but it runs region wide. Like the it's not country wide at this point, but it is this ability to say every town, city, village in my region has to use Socrata.
Yeah, but it
lends a different character to how quickly we can communicate with our data.
But maybe not necessarily a specific platform, but maybe if there were the ability to compel a specific open standard for format. So not specifying what the format is in the law, but allowing them to say...
Right, which we can't do, which we wouldn't do.
Right, but allowing the law to say, okay, we're going to pick this open platform. It has to be an open... public domain, whatever format, so that you can guarantee everyone can do it, and the vendors have to either adjust what they support to work with it, and then so their next upgrade would work with that, or they would have to sacrifice the business. That way you could at least offset that, or offload that cost.
I mean, Barbara Collins said, and maybe not here, but another appearance, is that her function as chief data officer is to help develop those standards, and then they would aim for an executive order. So I think the state's heading in that direction and would probably be interested in hearing from people, you know, about what those standards should look like. That's my impression.
So John, being the other lawyer in the room, maybe some of you else are lawyers too, I'm not sure, but do you think that we could come up with some language about that's simple enough to encompass this kind of let's get to the open data?
See, my take on it has always been very different. It's always a root sort of approach. And I look at data, government data, as a resource that needs to be managed in many ways. Mm-hmm. And it isn't managed consistently. So, for example, just, you know, the procurement of IT systems that lock data in. So if you want to move to somebody else's IT system, you can't do it because you didn't plan as part of the procurement process what the migration path would be at the end. That's no different to me than this issue. I think, you know, what happens to the data needs to be built in first. All of the considerations. You're creating data. You have IT systems that create data. Data is important. It's a resource. What do we need in terms of that data? We need it to be migratable. We need it to be open. We need it to be consistently standardized, et cetera, et cetera. I see a meta law as opposed to a tweak to the FOIA law as being the best way to go.
A meta law, meaning?
Meaning the New York State open data law. This is, you know, if the state uses IT systems that create data, this is what we need.
Yeah, that'd be great. So, say, for example, all data must be stored in a public domain documented format that is published for open access so that anyone can get data to and from it, and then you'll get spontaneous suggestions from all the computer scientists with time on their hands who say, hey, look, this is going to be a problem with sorting. It's going to slow down whatever aspect of it. And so that way you also get free electronic review of just the way that open source tends to work. And with public domain, then no one will be afraid to work with it.
So I think this is exactly bullseye, and when we were working on the city open data law, over the course of last year, this came up repeatedly, and we were politically stuck by fear about proprietary vendors, because they're seeking vendor lock-in. So, but it would be a great fight to have in the legislative arena. It's totally exactly
thank you.
Right.
And your question.
Okay.
Is anyone interested in 211, or are we?
Yeah, I'd love to.
Do you want to continue the conversation?
I'll go to 211 if you want. Yeah.